Good morning. Welcome to the House of the Lord, to St. Philip Lutheran Church here in Raleigh, North Carolina, for our service of worship and praise this Sunday morning. This is Transfiguration of Our Lord Sunday. It is the last Sunday in the season of Epiphany, and one where we recall, remember, and celebrate that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was transfigured on a mountaintop in front of his disciples, Peter, James, and John, as Moses and Elijah appeared with them and talked with them there. We are absolutely delighted that you have chosen to worship us with us this morning, either physically present here or online, virtually. We welcome you all in the name of Jesus. It is our hope and our prayer, as always, that this worship service will be both an uplift and an inspiration to you, as well as a comfort and a consolation to you in your time of need. We thank you, as always, for your continued financial support of our ministry here. It does not go unnoticed, and we appreciate you more than we can say. We would not be who we are, nor could we do all that we do, apart from your generosity. So thank you very much. You may continue to give either here, physically present, through the mail, or via our church website, which is stphilip.org. That's st-philip.org. And now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We ask that you please rise as you are able for the brief order of confession and forgiveness of sin found printed on page 2 of your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin now together in silence, trusting in the tender mercy of our God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us, that we may bathe in the glory of your Son, born among us, and reflect your love for all creation. Amen. Beloved, rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live now as freed and forgiven children of God. Amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is Jesus Shall Reign.
Yeah.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, mighty and immortal, you are beyond our knowing, yet we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Transform us into the likeness of your Son, who renewed our humanity so that we may share in his divinity. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated for the reading of God's holy word.
The first reading is from the 34th chapter of Exodus. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining. And Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsively Psalm 99. The Lord is king, let the people tremble. The Lord is enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth shake.
The Lord reigns high, his high above all.
Let them confess God's name, which is great and awesome. God is the Holy One.
Almighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord and fall down before God's footstool. God is the Holy One.
Moses and Aaron are your priests, and Samuel among those who call upon your name. O Lord, they call upon you, and you answer them.
You spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept your testimonies and the decree that you gave them. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord and worship upon God's holy hill, for the Lord our God is the Holy One. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from the third chapter of 2 Corinthians. Since then we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But their minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, that same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter, beginning with the 28th verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. Just then, a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly, a spirit seizes him, and all at once he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. "I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not." Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And all were astounded at the greatness of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Jesus on the mountain peak. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, indeed it is good for us to be here. It's good for us to be here in worship and in fellowship. We thank you for this assembly of saints. We thank you, Lord, for who you are and all that you do for us. We are always mindful of your goodness, your loving kindness, your steadfast mercy towards us. Our hearts are weighed down with the situation in Ukraine. While we sit here safely and securely, they are being bombarded and shelled. Lord, we ask that you would convert the necessary hearts and minds in this situation to seek a better way. We ask that warfare and bloodshed would cease, that your justice and peace would reign upon that land. Speak now to your servants the word that we need to hear, a word of challenge and conviction, of uplift and hope, of joy, transformation, and power. We love you, Lord. We thank you for first loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. My sermon text for this Transfiguration of Our Lord Sunday is the Gospel lesson, Luke chapter 9, verses 28 through 36, actually. So it's the first half of the Gospel reading that you heard, namely the story about the Transfiguration. My sermon title for this morning is based on the last three words of verse 34. The last three words of verse 34, namely, entering the cloud. Entering the cloud. We have before us this morning Luke's account of the transfiguration of Jesus, the Christ of Nazareth. To be transfigured is to be changed remarkably in form, which is precisely what happens here to Jesus on a mountain, which Scripture never names, but tradition has identified as Mount Tabor in Galilee. This profound event occurs in all three of the synoptic, that is similar, Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but not for some reason in John's Gospel. In all three cases, it is located approximately in the middle of the Gospel, thereby serving as a linchpin, a decisive turning point, a significant transition in Jesus' three-year ministry. Prior to this time, you see, Jesus has preached, taught, and performed various and sundry miracles. He has called and commissioned his disciples. Most all of this has occurred up north in Galilee. From now on, however, he and his disciples will turn south, journey towards Jerusalem of Judea, where Jesus will, of course, meet his fate of death. One could argue that a mountaintop experience of transfiguration and glory is a necessary reminder for a remaining arduous journey through the valley of the shadow of death. Liturgically speaking, the transfiguration of Jesus always concludes the season of Epiphany, a season which always begins with Jesus' baptism. The word Epiphany actually means a revelation or a manifestation of something. And in this case, it is the revelation or manifestation of Jesus of Nazareth as the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed Son of God. This fact is accomplished by God the Father speaking from heaven only twice in these three synoptic Gospels, once at Jesus' baptism, once at his transfiguration, both times saying the same thing, "This is my beloved Son," adding at his baptism, "with whom I am well pleased," and adding here at his transfiguration, "listen to him." So, from the first Sunday of the season of Epiphany to the last, from the depths of the River Jordan to the heights of Mount Tabor, from down south in Judea to up north in Galilee, From the witness of John the Baptist to the witness of Peter, James, and John, the identity of this one is constant and unchanging. He is God's Son, in whom God is well pleased and to whom we are to listen attentively. The so-called parallel texts for this Lucan account are found in Matthew 17 and Mark 9. As always, there are intriguing differences in detail. Only here in Luke is the purpose of this mountainous ascent to pray. Indeed, the transfiguration takes place precisely while Jesus is praying. Only here in Luke is the topic of conversation with Moses and Elijah revealed, namely Jesus' departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Only here in Luke are Peter and his companions, namely James and John, said to be weighed down with sleep. Tellingly, only here in Luke are the disciples terrified, quote unquote, as they enter into the overshadowing cloud. And finally, only herein does it conclude with the disciples' reaction. And they kept silent. In those days, told no one any of the things they had seen. Other details, which are common to all three accounts, bear mentioning. The mention of Peter, James, and John alone out of the group of 12 in verse 28 indicates an inner circle, if you will, of Jesus' most trusted disciples. While Jesus, of course, does many things in the presence of the 12, in other words, only these three are included here at his transfiguration, at his earlier resurrection of Jairus' daughter from the dead, and at his yet-to-come final prayer of agony in Gethsemane's garden. The appearance of Moses and Elijah with him here in verse 30 is doubly significant, actually. First of all, they represent respectively the law and the prophets, two of the three overarching blocks of material in the Old Testament, which bear witness to this good news gospel which Jesus now embodies. And secondly, all three of these figures will, in some sense, cheat death. According to the book of Deuteronomy, the location of Moses' death and burial place is shrouded in mystery and has remained unknown even to this very day. Elijah, of course, was whisked away alive, actually into heaven, by horses and a chariot and a whirlwind of fire, according to 2 Kings, while Jesus, as you know, will be resurrected from the grave on the third day after his death. Peter's initial cry of verse 33 is timely, appropriate, and moving, even if his follow-up remark is not. Lord, it is good for us to be here. Last of all, the transfiguration itself is summed up powerfully, if briefly, in verse 29. The appearance of Jesus' face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. There is in this text, my friends, something unique to Luke's gospel, something ironic and illogical. In an epiphany season of light, the light of recognition and awareness, the light of revelation and elucidation, verse 34 relates that a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud, a voice spoke, saying. Gregory of Nyssa, N-Y-S-S-A, a town in ancient Turkey, Gregory of Nyssa was an ancient church father of the 4th century. He once wrote a book entitled The Life of Moses, which went on to become a Christian classic. The Life of Moses was Gregory's commentary on the book of Exodus, chapters 1 through 20, wherein he, Gregory, detected Moses' soul to be mystically transformed into the image of God. This kind of transformation, incidentally, is based on 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, and 18, part of our second lesson for today, which states, "And we all are being changed into the Lord's likeness from one degree of glory to another." We all are being changed into the Lord's likeness from one degree of glory to another. We normally don't talk about the fact that we are being changed, being transformed ourselves in this life into the image of Christ. And yet passages such as 2 Peter 1 and verse 4 testify that you and I are becoming partakers of the divine nature. We are becoming partakers of the divine nature. Reflecting on Moses' life in Exodus, Gregory posits three stages of ascent to God. And ironically, and somewhat counterintuitively, he locates them in a movement from light to darkness. Somewhat paradoxically, he begins with what he calls the way of light, which is a purification of the soul, proceeds to illumination, which for him occurs in the cloud, and then he ends in darkness. Moses' vision of God began with light, you see, on Mount Sinai, the burning bush, etc. Then God spoke more at length with Moses in the cloud that descended upon Mount Sinai later on. And finally, Moses climbed higher and higher and encountered God, Scripture says, in the darkness. It's a fascinating and provocative line of thought, actually. In Exodus chapter 19, the text says that a thick cloud descended upon the mountain. The Lord summoned Moses up the mountain and into the cloud. While verse 20 culminates, then the people stood at a distance while Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. For Gregory of Nyssa then, darkness represents the infinity of God. Darkness is the place where one contemplates the invisible, namely God's eternity. All of this, of course, is exactly the opposite of the way you and I normally think about God. We seek to come out of darkness and into the light. We want to emerge from a murky fog of misunderstanding into the bright light of clarification. Much of this line of thinking comes from scriptures originating from the beloved disciple John. You may recall, Jesus is the light which shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. I am the light of the world, Jesus says. Whoever follows me walks not in darkness, but has the light of life. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. And of course, John tends to use such categories metaphorically, equating them with good and evil, love and hate, etc. And yet we cannot forget seminal moments in Scripture when God encounters God's people and operates for their blessing not in light, but instead in darkness. Jacob, for example, profoundly wrestled with God to obtain his blessing at night, not in the day. When God parts the Red Sea to deliver God's children from slavery in Egypt, he does so at night, not in the day. And in the opening two verses of the Bible, right before God says, "Let there be light," it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and God's Spirit was moving over the waters." So maybe the darkness is not in God, but God is in the darkness. So even though it might be puzzling and counterintuitive, Gregory poses, based on Moses, that to ascend to God, to become more godlike, be formed into God's image, means to move from light to the cloud to darkness. So, as I look at this text, these three disciples may see Jesus transfigured in a swath of light, but they don't hear the voice of God. They don't hear the voice of the eternal until they enter the cloud. They may be visually dazzled by some sort of kaleidoscopic light show at first, but they don't come to comprehension until the oral announcement, "This is my son, my chosen, listen to him." In the fireworks, Peter is amazed, bedazzled, and stammers away in a confused manner, "Let us make three dwelling places, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While the result of the cloud and the darkness where God is silence in verse 36. A cloud came and overshadowed them, verse 34 begins. And they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Why would they be terrified? because a cloud is the opposite of light. It's murky. It's confusing. It obscures and obfuscates. It prohibits clarity. It prevents precision. But from the cloud comes a voice. Eugene Peterson, in his Message paraphrase translation of the Bible, records here, as they found themselves buried in the cloud, they became deeply aware of God. Sometimes, my friends, you only become deeply aware of God when you are buried in the cloud. Sometimes you only hear the voice of God in the cloud. Maybe a cloud has overshadowed you in your own life. Maybe you are terrified as you are entering this cloud. The cloud could be ominous or foreboding circumstances. The cloud can be various trials and tribulations. It could be low self-esteem, anxiety, stress, loneliness, depression, divorce, being overwhelmed, the fear of facing sickness or death. Regardless, the cloud obscures, and so you are not able to get your bearings. But if you don't hear anything else I say today, if you don't hear anything else out of the scripture this morning, know that God is in the cloud. God is in the thick darkness. God speaks from within that cloud. Psalm 18 says, God made darkness His covering around Him. God made His canopy thick clouds dark with water. So on this day of transfiguration, in this season of Epiphany, rejoice in the light, yes. Walk in the light that God both is and gives. Sing, shine, Jesus, shine. The Lord is my light and my salvation. This little light of mine, and we are marching in the light of God. But when the cloud comes, and it will come, when the cloud descends upon you, and it will, and when you become afraid, and you will, know that God is in the cloud too, and God speaks precisely from the cloud. When you can no longer see anything because of that cloud, hear the divine voice. Do not fear. I will never leave you, nor fail you, nor forsake you. When you can no longer detect north from south or east from west, hear the voice. Nothing in all of creation shall ever be able to separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Remember the words of St. Paul. We walk as yet by faith, not by sight. And faith comes from what is heard, not from what is seen. From what is heard, and what is heard comes by the preaching of Christ. So then faith comes from the cloud. Oh, I think I can hear old Job say, behold, I go forward, but God is not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive God. On the left hand, I seek God, but I cannot behold Him. I turn to the right hand, but I cannot see Him there either. But God knows the way I take. When He has tried me, I shall come forth as pure gold. Oh, in the thick darkness of the cloud, we fear for our lives. We fear because we cannot see the path clearly, much less the outcome. But in the darkness, I hear a voice. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. He who is within you is greater than he who is in this world. You are more than a conqueror. You were chosen before the very foundation of the world itself. You are fearfully, you are wonderfully made. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. I have carried you from the womb, even to old age and gray hairs, I will still carry you. My friends, when we see a glorified, transfigured Jesus and or hear the divine voice of reassurance from the thick cloud, we can conclude right along with Peter, Lord, it is good for us to be here. When we hear the word of God and receive the sacrament of communion, it is good for us to be here. When we hear the good news that all of our sins are forgiven, not just some of them, but all of them, not just partially, but entirely and completely, Lord, it is good for us to be here. When we pray together, sing together, and fellowship together, it is good for us to be here. When the world discourages us and oppresses us and beats us down and overwhelms us throughout the week, it is good for us to be here worshiping God in spirit and in truth, being reminded of who God is, what God can do, and who we are in Him. Though we oftentimes enter the cloud uneasily, we do hear the divine voice. We are being brought closer to God despite and sometimes through our sufferings. And we are being transformed into the image of Christ from one degree of glory, yea, unto another. Isn't it good? Isn't it good for us to be here, entering the cloud? Amen. We invite you to please rise as you are able. So we join together in singing our hymn of the day, Jesus on the Mountain Peak.
Living together in trust and hope, we profess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Transform us by your greatness, O God. Send us down the mountain to share joy with all people. Make us agents of change, confident that your hope will vanquish despair and your goodness will conquer evil. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
The mountains and valleys sing your praise. Dazzle us with your presence in every landscape, bluffs built by ancient glaciers, canyons carved by flowing rivers, flat horizons with uninterrupted views, and sand shaped by ocean tides. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You love justice and establish equity. Strengthen leaders of local governments, community nonprofits, and grassroots campaigns. Bless them with gifts of integrity, creativity, and sound conscience. Build up safe and joyful communities where all people may thrive. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Heal those who are in distress. Give patience to those waiting for answers. Grant hope to those who have reached the limits of treatment. Give compassionate hearts to those who accompany loved ones through illness and uncertainty. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Today we shout Alleluia from the mountaintop. This week we enter the wilderness of Lent. Bless all who contribute and lead us in worship during this change of season. Pastors, deacons, musicians, and all who contribute to our worship life. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Blessed are they who listened to Christ's voice in this life and now rest with him. Transform us from glory into glory and give us your peace that we do not lose heart. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
O God, most mighty, most merciful, our sacred stories tell us that you help and save your people. You are the fortress. May there be no more war. You are the harvest. May there be no more hunger. You are the light. May no one die alone or in despair. Lay your healing hand on those we name aloud or silently and give them hope, comfort, and peace. Marlene. We share the love of Christ with everyone. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and in faith through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen.
As the family of Saint Philip, we ask that you open our ears to hear your call for us and guide our feet in following. Help us to be good stewards of our time and treasure and to put our trust in you to provide. We ask for blessings on the life of our pastor and that your spirit guide us in relationship and ministry. We put our hope in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's peace with each other now, as well as with those worshiping online with us via the back cameras. God's peace be with you. Julie, God's peace be with you. Thank you. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, sovereign of the universe. You offer us new beginnings and guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table, nourish us with this heavenly food, and prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ our light, amen.
Thank you.
We celebrate together now the Lord's Supper, the feast of Holy Communion. Now may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who, sharing our life, lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to your own brilliant light. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Scripture tells us that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we now pray together as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to God's table. There is a place for you and enough for all. You may be seated for the distribution. All are welcome to the Lord's table. Children are invited forward for a blessing. Please follow the directions found printed in your bulletin and of the ushers. Please remember to maintain social distance by family units at the altar rail. Come now and receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins and eternal life.
Thank you.
We invite all of you who feel that it is good for us to be here to please rise as you are able to receive our post-communal blessing. Now may the eating of Christ's body and the drinking of his blood strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to bring good news and to proclaim your favor to all. Strengthen with the richness of your grace. In your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Partners in ministry, what is our calling?
Jesus asked that we love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. Jesus tells us that a second is like it. We shall love our neighbors as ourselves. We answer that call, and we go out to share the love of Christ. Thanks be to God.
A few quick announcements, mission opportunities. Number one, Mark Andrews is celebrating a milestone birthday today. So Mark is not with us, but he is worshiping virtually. So Mark, happy birthday from your church family. There will be a senior adult ministry meeting this coming Wednesday at 9:30 a.m. here in the music room. No Bible study Wednesday, either in the morning or in the evening. We'll resume Bible study in 2 weeks. Reason being that Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. So we have an Ash Wednesday service here at 7 p.m. It'll be here in the sanctuary. If you're not able to make that, you can join us online via Zoom. And Ash Wednesday, of course, begins our Lenten season, which is a 40-day season, an imitation of Jesus' 40 days in the wilderness, leading up to Christ's passion, death, and resurrection. And finally, on Saturday, March the 12th, we will have a new members class. That is from 10 a.m. until 12 p.m. It's only 2 hours. Refreshments will be served. It's an opportunity for us to gather together as newcomers to this church, to meet one another, to take a tour of the building, to learn briefly about the history of this congregation and the opportunities for you to serve. So if you are at all interested, even if you're not convinced that you want to join yet, if you're just interested, you don't have to join, you can come on out. That's Saturday, March the 12th from 10 a.m. until 12 p.m. noon. Are there any further announcements? Yes, Carol. Amen. Word on the street is that the mysterious guest speaker is a handsome gentleman. That's all I know, though. I hear he's also quite the raconteur, but beyond that, I don't know anything. If there are no further announcements, receive the benediction of our Lord. And now may God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you and who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in today and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn this Transfiguration Sunday is Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Thank you.
Go with Christ into a weary world. Share the good news. Thanks be to God.
Congratulations, you guys.
Thank you.
I haven't seen you since, but...